Well, when you look through the book of Hebrews, and I'm sure all of us have, we find that it's a little bit unique. Like the book of Revelation, very unique. Also, the book of Hebrews is unique in that it discloses, as no other New Testament document does, how Christ fulfills the shadows that are provided in the sanctuary, the sacrifices, and the priesthood of the Old Testament. I'm sure you've noticed that. No other book deals with it like the book of Hebrews does. And of course, in that we see such rich and deep Christology. We see information there that pertains to our salvation in such a powerful way. You find that for example, the Old Covenant High Priest, when you go back and read about the function of the High Priesthood in the Old Covenant, how he went into the most holy place one day of the year on the Day of Atonement. And then you come to the book of Hebrews and you see how that relates to what Christ has accomplished for us in a way that you find in no other place. We know that just as in the Old Covenant, the High Priest went into that most holy place, and you can imagine what kind of feeling the people had on that day as they gathered around the tabernacle and later the temple. When he went into there, it was their understanding that he was not just going into some fancy building. Oh, no. He was going into the very presence of God with the blood of the sin offerings on behalf of the people. And then the same day they would see him come out of there, and they would see a visible representation in the second goat of their sins being removed from them. In other words, that which separated them from their God who dwelt in the most holy place, they would see those sins being carried away, figuratively speaking. So you can imagine how powerful that was. And we can only appreciate what the writer of the book of Hebrews says when we understand that, about how Jesus Christ, the true high priest, went into the holy place not made with hands, the real holy place where God actually does dwell, not with the blood of others, the blood of animals, but with his own blood on our behalf. So it's a very powerful book, and as you begin to read through it, you begin to realize that how those Old Covenant, Old Testament shadows find their fulfillment in Christ. Now, the original readers of this epistle, the book of Hebrews, obviously spoke Greek because it's written in Greek, and you see that the writer quotes from repeatedly the Septuagint, which means the original readers obviously would have had familiarity with the Septuagint. That's the Greek translation of the Old Covenant Scriptures. They were predominantly, if not entirely, Jewish. That becomes very clear because the writer is speaking about things that a Jewish audience would have the most knowledge about. You know, if the people had been converted right out of paganism, then the writer wouldn't have been talking about the details of the temple, the sacrifices, the priesthood, and all these other things, many other things that you read about in the Hebrew Scriptures. And of course, the LXX or Septuagint, the translation of the Hebrew Scriptures. So it is very evident that the book is well named, called Book of Hebrews, because it's recognized and has been for many, many centuries that it was an entirely, or predominantly, if not entirely, Jewish audience. Also, we understand that these were not just a group of Jews, these were believing Jews. Now, there's an important piece of information. You wonder, what is this book all about? What did the writer have in mind? What was his goal? If you look at Hebrews chapter 10, there's a very important piece of information here. Hebrews chapter 10, and beginning in verse 32, he says, "But recall the former days in which after you are illuminated," this is when you came to a knowledge of the truth regarding who the true Messiah was, when you were converted, "you endured great struggle with sufferings." He's saying, recall that. This is very important. These people had already endured a great struggle with sufferings early in their conversion. He says, partly while you were made a spectacle both by reproaches and tribulations, and partly while you became companions of those who were so treated. So evidently there were two different aspects, a couple of different ways in which they experienced the struggles and the persecutions. It may be, and some commentators believe this is the case, that what the writer has in mind here is the expulsion of the Jews from Rome in AD 49. Under the Roman Emperor Claudius. And of course, those Jewish Christians in Rome would have been in that number. So what do you have here? They were uprooted and told to leave. That's always painful. So they had companions, been the Jewish community in general, but here they were Christians. And somewhere along the way, guess what? They were not so well received by their Jewish brothers and sisters, their Jewish fellow citizens. So here they were really on the outs, weren't they? You had them being rejected by the Romans, expelled from Rome, and then you had their own brethren distancing themselves from them. So evidently that's what the writer has in mind here. He goes on to say, "For you had compassion on me in my chains, and joyfully accepted the plundering of your goods, knowing that you have a better and an enduring possession for yourselves." It says in heaven. That's not in the original manuscript, apparently. "Therefore," he says, "do not cast away your confidence, which has great reward." Let's continue on there to verse, all the way down to verse 39. It says, "For you have need of endurance, so that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise." So it is obvious here that he is concerned that they will not endure because they've already endured so much, and now they're beginning to get tired. Now they're beginning to be tempted to walk away from it. You know, and there comes that time in the lives of a lot of people when they say, "I've had enough." And they can begin to just kind of move away from what they know to be the truth. Verse 37, "For yet a little while," he's quoting the scriptures now, he says, "and he who is coming will come and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith, but if anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in him." So he's warning them here. He's putting out this caution. Anyone who draws back, once you have been enlightened, as you have, once you have endured the struggle, as you have, and now when you begin to draw back, God has no pleasure in that person. So he's giving them this precaution. But then he gives some encouragement by saying, "But we are not of those who draw back to perdition, but of those who believe to the saving of the soul." You know, putting out that hopeful bit of information there. But he knows that there's a real risk for some people in that number because of what they've had to endure. Now, so that's some things that are in the past. Let's go on over to chapter 13, see some things that are in the present. Chapter 13, he says, beginning in verse 11, "For the body," he's talking about the sacrificial system. He says, "For the bodies of those animals whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest for sin are burned outside the camp. Therefore, Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered outside the gate." Why do you suppose he's bringing this up at this point? Jesus suffered outside the gate. He says, "Therefore, let us go forth to him outside the camp, bearing his reproach." What happened to Jesus? Expulsion. He was taken outside the camp to be crucified, expelled by his own people, rejected by his own people. What is the implication here? That these folks, these Jewish Christians, were being rejected by their own. And he's saying, the writer's saying, "Well, let us go outside the camp like Jesus did when he was rejected and bear his reproach." So listen, look at all that they were going through here. First of all, probably expulsion from Rome, and then suffering and shame for their confession of Jesus, and then stripped of the institutions of their Jewish religion. You think about that. They had gone there, many of these people had made the pilgrimage festivals, had gone to the feasts from year to year. If they lived in Italy, The thought is that they probably did. But they would make that trip, and they would get there, and they would arrive, and you can imagine the feeling they would have had of knowing they were in the city of the great king. They were right there before that magnificent temple, and it was in the time of Jesus, that magnificent structure, and they knew this was the house of God. They knew that God dwelt in the inner sanctuary. They knew that they were blessed above all the peoples of the earth because God chose them to have Him dwell in their midst. He gave them this land. He made all these promises, and they knew about the promises of the restored kingdom. And they looked for that. They awaited that. They longed for it. So here they were stripped of all of that now. Not allowed, probably not even allowed to come to the temple any longer. And evidently this was before the temple was destroyed. Every indication inside the book of Hebrews is that the temple still stood. But now they were being distanced, put at a distance by their own people. And apparently didn't have access to many of these things that they were so accustomed to, and they were so important to them culturally. And then finally, there's the confusion due to the glory of God. Keep in mind what they had in mind, what they were accustomed to, seeing that temple, knowing that God dwelt in it, seeing all of these things, understanding what the prophet said about the restoration of the kingdom, about the glory of the city of the great king once Messiah comes. And now what are they being told? That the glory of God is veiled in the sufferings of Jesus. And now hidden away in heaven. Not exactly what they were expecting from the outset, was it? No. So you can imagine the feeling. You can imagine how they must have felt at this point. It's lonely out here. It's cold. It's dark. We're hungry. You can kind of identify with that. I think everybody can to some extent, some measure can identify with that. And that's what they were feeling, no doubt, at this point. And they were tempted, some of them were tempted to turn away from the faith once for all delivered. And that's why the writer of Hebrews is addressing them. That's a major theme. Do not turn away. Do not turn back. Look at Hebrews chapter 12. Chapter 12, and in beginning there, and one thing I might mention here that is that one of the outstanding features of the book of Hebrews is its high literary style. It's a very high literary style. You'll see an example of this right here in chapter 12. But keep in mind what I just said about this hidden and veiled glory. You can imagine here is this humble teacher from Nazareth struggling along, bearing the weight of his cross, surrounded by Roman soldiers, beaten and bleeding and going to the place of death. And the glory of God is in that? Yes. Yeah. The same one who's nailed to the stake and cries out just before he dies, my God, why have you forsaken me? That's the glory of God, veiled in all of that. But it's not what the people expected. Not what they expected. And now then, once the resurrection occurs, once he appears to the disciples, and now we're getting things on track, well, what happens? Well, that glory is hidden away in heaven. So if it's hidden out of sight, your physical eyes, you don't see it, you're not there every day to experience it in that way, then the only eyes you can see with are the eyes of faith. And so the writer then says in Hebrews chapter 12, let's just take up the context there, the beginning in verse 18 to get down to where we want to go. It says, for you have not come to the mountain that may be touched, and that burn with fire. He's referring to Mount Sinai in the time of Moses, when Moses went up to receive the tablets of stone, when the commandments were given, and to blackness and darkness and tempest, and the sound of a trumpet, and the voice of words, so that those who heard it begged that the word should not be spoken to them anymore, for they could not endure what was commanded. And if so much as a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned or shot with an arrow. And so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I am exceedingly afraid and trembling. Now get this. What he's saying here, even though the glory of God now appears to be veiled and is out of sight in heaven, but here's the way you look at it. Now comes the eyes of faith. He says, but you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly of the church of the firstborn who are registered in heaven, to God the judge of all, to the spirits of just men made perfect, to Jesus the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood sprinkled that speaks better things than that of Abel. He has in mind in this latter statement here the scripture that says that where God says the blood of your brother Abel cries to me from the ground. He says you have come to this blood that speaks better things than the blood of Abel. So this is the way you look at it. When you're in this time of darkness and trial and desperation, you realize you haven't come to this mountain as the Israelites did. You've come to something far greater. Mount Zion, the city of the living God. And even though you can't see it with physical eyes, you see it with the eyes of faith. You know it's there. You know it's real. That's what you put your confidence in. And in chapter 11, we're all familiar with that. Excuse me. You have all this list of the heroes of faith. They would all have been familiar with each name that's mentioned here because, after all, they were Jewish. They knew about those were the Jewish, or they looked on them as the heroes of faith. Going back all the way back to Abel, and then Enoch, and then you have Noah, Abraham, Sarah, Isaac, Jacob, and Moses, and on it goes. All these heroes of faith in chapter 11. And then in chapter 12, look what he says. After listing all of these and hopefully encouraging them by showing them an example of faith and pointing out that they too saw with the eyes of faith. You know, Abraham was promised this land. He goes to the land. He winds up paying for a plot of land to bury his wife. Wait a minute, I thought he was going to inherit this land. He dwelt in that land as what we would call a resident alien. He was there, but he didn't really possess it. It says he looked for that city that has foundations. In other words, he looked at the promise of God and he saw that city through the eyes of faith. And then he says in chapter 12, after going through all this whole list of people who were people of faith, chapter 12 and verse 1 says, therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, what witnesses? The ones he just named. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. In other words, let's look at what God promises through the eyes of faith and not depend on what we see around us. Not depend on and not be worried about the persecutions that may come your way, the struggles you have to endure, the people who are against you. No, you look at the promises. You look through the eyes of faith. And then in verse 2, looking unto Jesus, thank you, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand in the throne of God. So this is the point here is that you do as those heroes of faith did in the Old Testament. You see the promises through the eyes of faith. And then you can know you have come to Mount Zion, the city of the living God. And that's what you hold to as you face the struggles that life will hand out to you. Now, with that background information, we'll get into the sermon. A little bit. That's the background information. That's what was going on. It's very important to see that. But what I want to do is look at chapter 4, because I think it's always important that you understand what's going on. If you take one part of a book, you need to know what's in the backdrop. And so that's what we do. Now that we have the backdrop, we have the background information, we can look at chapter 4. We're going to begin in chapter 3, actually, and read down to chapter 4 and then unpack the contents of chapter 4 and see what it has to say to us. It's some very, very important and I would say deeply theological information here that is applicable to every age. It's not just limited to one particular time in history, but it's very important to us today. In chapter 3, let's look at verse 12. He says, "Beware, brethren, lest there be any of you, in any of you, a heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily while it is called today." And by the way, the title of today's sermon is Today. "While it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end." In other words, that faith which you embraced in the beginning, we are in fellowship with Christ. We have become partakers with Christ of this inheritance if we persist to the end, if we hold it. Now, why would he be saying this? Because some were tempted to let go of it, to turn away from it. He goes on then to quote from Psalm 95 to make his point. He says, "Today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion." He's talking about the rebellion in the days of the wilderness, when Israel was in the wilderness, and how the people, the Exodus generation, did not enter the promised land, but they were rebellious. So here is Psalm 95, and I think it's important before we continue that we go back to Psalm 95 and look and see exactly what he's talking about there. Look at Psalm 95. It begins by saying, "Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. Let us shout joyfully to him with psalms, for the Lord is the great God." And then he goes on to say later, down in verse 8, says, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. That's where the writer of Hebrews is quoting from. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. He goes on to say, as in the day of trial in the wilderness, when your fathers tested me, they tried me, though they saw my work for 40 years. I was grieved with that generation and said, it is a people who go astray in their hearts, and they do not know my ways. So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Now there's another theme right there. Entering God's rest. What did he have in mind here? Well, let's go back to Deuteronomy chapter 12. Deuteronomy chapter 12 and see what he's referring to. And beginning in verse 8, you shall not at all do as we're doing here today, every man doing what is right in his own eyes. For as yet you have not come to the rest and the inheritance which the Lord your God is giving you. But when you cross over the Jordan and dwell in the land which the Lord your God is giving you to inherit, and he gives you rest from all your enemies round about, so that you dwell safely, to dwell in safety, then there will be the place where the Lord your God chooses to make his name abide. So once you enter into the land, then you have entered into the rest. You can rest from all that has gone before, all the battles, all the enemies. You have rest. And then God will put his tabernacle in the midst of you and dwell in your midst. That's rest. That's what he has in mind. But here what he tells the people in the wilderness, or what the psalmist in chapter 95, in Psalm 95 is referring to, is the fact that because of their rebellion, they did not enter that rest. Joshua brought them in, but as the writer of the book of Hebrews will tell us, even he did not give them rest. But what I want to call your attention to is he's referring to this psalm when he says, "Today, if you hear his voice, do not burden your hearts," or harden your hearts, I should say, "as in the rebellion." So today. Now, we could look at that and say, well, okay, that was for those people back there. But you're going to see that the writer of Hebrews applies that to us. Says, no. It's not just for them back there. It's for us here. Let's see how he develops that theme. Back to chapter 3, verse 16 now. "For who having heard rebelled? Indeed, was it not all who came out of Egypt led by Moses? Now with whom was he angry 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose corpses fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who did not obey?" And I want you to notice something here. He's talking about obedience. And then he says, you want a good definition of what it means to obey or what it means to believe. If you think there's some kind of contradiction between obeying or believing, you know, obedience or faith, well, look at this. He says it was those who did not obey. And then he goes on to say, verse 19, "So we see then that they could not enter in because of unbelief." So unbelief and disobedience are synonymous. If you're disobedient, you're not a believer. That's the bottom line. So when you see some of these essays and books and whatnot floating around talking about true grace, you don't have to worry about that law, you don't have to worry about changing your life and all that. And God is able to change your wander, and in the meantime, you do what you want. Just don't pay any attention to that. Continuing on now in chapter 4, and this is what we want to focus on, chapter 4. "Therefore, since a promise remains of entering his rest, let us fear lest any of you seem to have come short of it." You see, what he's developing his theme from is the fact that here was the psalm, in Psalm 95, written long after the rebellion in the wilderness, and he's still saying, "Today, when you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts." And he goes on to point out that you can enter his rest. So you could still enter his rest long after the rebellion, long after the children of Israel crossed over. But Joshua, as we're going to see, never did truly give them rest. There still remains a promise for entering his rest. That means entering into fellowship with him. Well, let's continue on here. Verse 2, "For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them." The good news was preached to them. God offered them rest. And now God is offering us rest. Same thing. "But the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it." In other words, they didn't believe it, they did not obey it. That's what it means. It was not mixed with faith. "For we who have believed do enter that rest, as he has said, 'So I swore in my wrath that they shall not enter my rest.'" Those who have not believed, those who have not obeyed, do not enter the rest. We who have believed and obeyed, of course, we have, or we are entering that rest. And by the way, when he's talking about the rest here, sometimes he seems to say we've already entered it. Other times he seems to say it's future. Well, it's future, and from his perspective, we're in the process of entering it. We're entering it. We haven't arrived yet. We're entering it. We have a sample of it, you might say. We're experiencing it beforehand, as it were. We have a taste of it. We're having a taste of the world to come, but we have not arrived yet. So that's what he has in mind here. He says, "Although the works were finished from the foundation of the world." Now he's going to link this promised rest with something else. Another reference to rest. Now listen, watch what he does here. "For he has spoken in a certain place of the seventh day in this way, and God rested on the seventh day from all his works." And again, in this place, they shall not enter my rest. You see what he's doing? God entered his rest on the seventh day. Talking about Genesis 2. You know, after the 6 days of creation, on the seventh day, he enters his rest. What is the implication there? Was it because he was just slap wore out and tired from working all week? Why enter the rest? So he could regenerate his spiritual batteries? No. What did he have in mind when he entered his rest? What he did on the sixth day. He made a creature bearing his image and likeness. So he enters his rest for the good of the of that creature. That's what that's about. That's why Jesus can say the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So that's what the Sabbath rest was all about. And we understand then that God was inviting man to enter his rest all the way back creation week. And here he is, you see how the writer of Hebrews is making that connection between the rest that the Israelites were could enter into by going into the promised land, having God dwell in their midst, and yet they blew it. And he's saying that they're continuous, there is now, even now, there's still a promise of rest, and that's the one we're invited to enter into. Now, what's interesting here about the linkage to the seventh day is that it tells us that it points to a rest that's yet future. You know, I remember some years ago there was some discussion over the Sabbath being a sign of the old covenant, and someone argued, "Oh no! It's not a sign of the old covenant." Well, yeah, sure it was. What's the problem with that? Does that mean it's not a sign of anything else? For them, it was a sign of the old. It symbolized the covenant relationship they had with God. But here, the writer of the book of Hebrews tells us that the Sabbath is a sign or symbol, that's what it means, a symbol of that ultimate rest that we can enter into, that we are entering. So it tells you that the Sabbath points to something yet future. It's not something that's all in the past. He continues on. Verse 6, since therefore it remains that some must enter it, and those to whom it was first preached did not enter because of disobedience. Again, he designates a certain day, saying in David, today, after such a long time, as it has been said, today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. So his point here is that in quoting Psalm 95, all the way out on the time of David, this is long after the wilderness sojourning, long after that, and he's saying even after this such a long period of time, there's still a promise of entering his rest. So that's not just past history. I said, boy, if I'd have been back then, I'd have entered his rest. I'd have been a good one. I'd have been one of the good Israelites. Well, that's history, but his point here is there still is a promise of entering his rest, meaning entering into fellowship with him, entering into a relationship with him. And so the lesson still is today, as long as you can call it today. As long as you can call it today. Today, when you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Now, have you heard his voice today? Yes, you have. If you've been reading these words, you're hearing his voice. So the lesson to us is today, right now, this day, when we hear his voice through these words, don't harden your hearts. Verse 8, for if Joshua had given them rest, that he would not afterward have spoken of another day. That makes sense, doesn't it? Why would David say much later, today, when you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts, and talked about a rest, if Joshua had already done it, if it's already past history and there's nothing else of the promise? No. He says, there remains therefore a rest, a sabbatismos, or a Sabbath keeping for the people of God. Now, he is, you know, even though he does have this future rest in mind, it's obvious by his linkage, what he's already linked this to the seventh day, to the Sabbath, it is obvious that he has, what he has in mind here is that the Sabbath symbolizes that future rest. That rest we shall enter into, that rest we are now entering into through the process. Verse 10, for he who has entered his rest has himself also ceased from his works as God did from his. Verse 11, let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience. Once again, this tells us that the writer of the book of Hebrews was dealing with a serious problem there. He recognized that there was a real danger for some of the people because of all that they'd endured and all that they'd been confronted with, and the fact that they'd come into this kind of a cold darkness and perhaps depression and despondency as a result. Now, there was a real danger that they were beginning to walk away from the rest that they'd already begun to enter into. So he's saying, don't let that happen. Don't let it happen. Remember the example of those who've gone before. Don't let their example of disobedience go unnoticed and unheeded. It says in verse 12, for the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. When he says word of God, it's pretty clear what he's talking about. He's just been commenting on the revelation of God through Psalm 95, through the example of the children of Israel in the wilderness. All of this is divine revelation that has come down to them, and he's saying that this word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. In other words, it cuts to the bone. It exposes what's inside. And by looking at the word of God, by hearing his voice through the word of God, then we're able to see what's really in there. We're able to see ourselves as we really are. And then, when we come to that place, we're able to repent and obey and do what the people of Israel in the time of the wilderness were not able to do or did not do. It says, and there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him whom we must give account. So he knows us. He sees us. We need to see ourselves. And that's the effect of hearing his voice. If you really listen to it, if you heed it, that's the effect it has. It lets you see yourself and then enables you to do what you need to do. Verse 14, seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace of help in time of need. You know, that's the end of the matter right there. That's it. He went through it. He endured it. Can you imagine how he felt when he was on the stake, having been tortured the way he was, bruised and bleeding, and now dying? As he cries out and he senses something different, he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Imagine that. But he stayed faithful right to the end. So he said, our high priest himself has set an example for us. He can sympathize with us. He can sympathize with our sufferings. So when we, like the people in that time, these people that the writer is addressing, who were being tempted to turn away from the faith once for all delivered, when they were facing the trials and difficulties of life, and it seemed so overwhelming that they wouldn't be able to make it another day, remember the one who went before us. Remember the author and finisher of our faith, the one who stands out front, and with him this crowd of witnesses who endured so many things because they could see the city that has foundations, not with physical eyes, but with the eyes of faith. If we hold to that, always look to that, always envision that and see with the eyes of faith the holy city, the heavenly Zion, and realize that we're surrounded by a multitude of angels, and see those cloud of witnesses having ever before our eyes, and especially as we look to the author and finisher of our faith, who endured what most humans never have to endure to secure our salvation, then, you know, we can make it. Then we can enter that rest. So today, when you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts.